The Italian political cartoonist Gabriele Galantara, who later became better known by his pen name Ratalanga, was born in Molto Lupponi in 1865, and as a child his talent for drawing was encouraged by his father. But his father died in 1884, and his mother pressured Gabriele into undertaking a mathematics degree at the University of Bologna. Predictably, he wasn't happy there and soon switched to the Academy of Fine Arts. In 1887, he collaborated with his friend Guido Podreca to create the satirical weekly magazine Bononia Ride, which reflected their radically socialist political views. And for a few years it was quite successful, but in 1891 they were accused of inciting a series of unruly student demonstrations and were forced to shut down. So Podreca and Galantara, who was now using the name Ratalanga, left Bologna for Rome, where they began publishing their new weekly magazine, L'Asino, in 1892. L'Asino quickly became even more popular than their previous venture, but in 1897 they were charged with producing subversive propaganda and shut down again. They re-emerged in 1900, and as well as making much more use of colour printing, they toned down some of their more vehemently political material and concentrated instead on attacking the Catholic Church, which surprisingly was considered fair game. And in this period, Galantara produced satires of events outside Italy, with frequent condemnations of the tyranny of the Russian Tsar. Despite the use of colour, Galantara was, like many cartoonists before and since, essentially a linear illustrator, and it was his expressive inking which defined his work. Nevertheless, the application of colour was far from an afterthought, and it did help to give his illustrations added substance. Around this time, Galantara also travelled around Europe and contributed to other magazines, such as L'Assiette au Beurre in France. And he created a large number of colour covers for the German magazine Der War Jakob, which held similar left-leaning views. And at this time it seemed he was almost as committed to this magazine as he was to his own back in Italy. But when the Great War began in 1914, Galantara turned his critical attention to Kaiser Wilhelm and Germany's role in the conflict, and he continued his relentless attacks until they were eventually defeated. And when not attacking Germany directly, he pulled no punches in his graphic condemnation of the tragedy of war and the loss of life. By the time the war ended, the relationship between Galantara and Podreca had become strained over differences in political opinion, and L'Asino closed down yet again in 1918. When publication resumed a couple of years later, it was under Galantara's exclusive control. But there were clear signs its best days were behind it and the use of colour printing was seriously reduced. At this time, L'Asino voiced strong opposition to Benito Mussolini's fascist party, and inevitably when they became the government, L'Asino was shut down for good in 1925. Not long after, Galantara was arrested, forbidden to work and kept under virtual house arrest up to his death in 1937 at the age of 72. Ezio Anichini was born in Florence in 1886, and sadly there's almost nothing else I can find in terms of biographical information. But it is recorded that his father was a successful artist, and it seems quite likely that it was in his father's studio that Ezio first learned to draw and paint. It's also known that he studied at the Academy of Fine Arts in Florence in 1902. But the earliest evidence of his work in print that I've found is his remarkable series of tonal line and wash monochromes for an Italian edition of J.M. Barrie's Peter Pan, which was first published in 1911. These engrossing and aesthetically pleasing illustrations demonstrate great maturity of technique, and it seems highly likely that this is yet another instance where earlier work has simply not survived. In the same year, he illustrated the first in what would be several volumes of the story of world history written by Laura Orvieto. There's remarkably little evidence of these books to be found, but what little there is features clean and simple line work in keeping with the classical subject matter. In 1912, he created his first cover illustration for the Florence-based arts magazine Sena Illustrata. The magazine had been published successfully since 1894 and was considered to be the major platform of what was better known as Art Nouveau, which Italians called Stile Liberty. So by the time Anichini began creating these covers, it was relatively late in the day, and the movement was to an extent already on the run from the onslaught of modernism spreading rapidly throughout Europe. But these cover illustrations skillfully blended heroic and romantic mythological and classical themes, set within aesthetically balanced graphic constructions, which clearly resonated with the influence of Alphonse Mucha. And in addition to his ongoing cover work, he also produced a series of 46 emotionally charged images based on the Virgin Mary, originally entitled The Litany of Loreto. They were first published as a magazine supplement for subscribers of Sena Illustrata in 1912, and this collection was enthusiastically received by critics and patrons of the arts throughout Italy. The images went on to also be distributed as a limited edition series of lavishly presented postcards for collectors. In 1919, Anichini's illustrations for Dante Alighieri's Divine Comedy were published, and this narrative collection was quite unlike his other work. It featured none of the expected decoration found in his magazine covers, and they were arguably more intense than his devotional work, with appropriately hellish flame colours printed over Anichini's densely cross-hatched drawings. But it was his professional association with Sena Illustrata which was his most enduring, and it continued into the 1920s, with very few, if any, concessions to the prevalent graphic obsession with modernity and futurism in Italian art and design. The last dated work I could find was from 1923, when Anichini would have been only 37 years old. It's known he also worked as a painter, and it may well be that's what he did subsequently, but all I can tell you for certain is he died in 1948 at the age of only 62. Giuseppe Riccobaldi is not only ignored by the world at large, but also seems to be largely forgotten in Italy. He doesn't even get a mention in Italian Wikipedia. He was born in Florence in 1887 and studied art at the Linguistica Academy of Genoa. And in 1908 he moved to Milan to work as an assistant theatrical set designer. It's known that he was working as an illustrator by 1916, but predictably there's nothing to show for it, and consequently I'm picking up his career in the early 1920s when examples of his poster design first appeared. And from that point onward, virtually his whole career would be as a highly successful designer and illustrator of posters. He quickly acquired a long line of clients from any number of industries, but travel and tourism were particularly prevalent in his strikingly modern output. Sadly, I haven't been able to uncover any definitive information about Riccobaldi's choice of medium. Examination of the images strongly suggests that both oils and watercolour can be ruled out, and he was undoubtedly using a generally opaque medium, such as gouache or maybe tempera, and applying it both flat and tonally with a wide range of brush techniques, even within the same poster. Whatever he was using to create these images, he seemed to have an innate understanding of how to make dramatically dynamic pictures which the viewer couldn't easily ignore. His style owed a lot to the Futurist movement, which was the most prevalent art style in Italy in the 1920s. And it's probably not coincidental that from an Italian perspective, it seemed to gel with Mussolini's much vaunted aspirations of discipline and efficiency. In 1928, he created the poster which is generally considered his most iconic image. The picture was of two cars ascending a gigantic ramp made of Fiat logos, and even if you've never heard of Riccobaldi, you may well be familiar with this image, as it's used in pretty much every book or blog about poster design. His bold geometric compositions also won over a number of shipping companies, and several of the most prominent, including Lloyd Triestino, put his talents to work in their advertising campaigns. And throughout the 1930s, he remained a dominant graphic presence across Italy, creating a large volume of advertising posters for major clients. In the years after the Second World War, Riccobaldi also began to work as an illustrator of children's books, and for these he softened his usual graphic approach considerably. He also created a line-only edition of Carlo Collodi's Pinocchio, but few would argue it was his most impressive work. But this recent aspect of his career was alongside rather than instead of his poster work, which continued throughout the later 1940s and 1950s. And the last dated poster I found is from 1959, at which point he dropped out of sight completely. It's more than likely that he simply retired, as he would have been 72 years old. And he died in Genoa in 1976, at the age of 89. Mario Labocetta is certainly one of the best-kept secrets I've encountered in the making of this series. And given how visually engaging and distinctive his work was, that makes no sense at all. He was born in Naples in 1899, but most of his working life was spent in Paris. Where he studied, if anywhere, I have no idea. When he first began working as an illustrator in the 1920s, he spent most of his time creating languid female figures, frequently not wearing much in the way of clothing, for several Parisian lifestyle and fashion magazines. Sometimes for reasons unknown, using the name Marillac. In 1930, he illustrated an edition of Voltaire's Candide, but the only evidence I can find is the cover. But in 1932, his edition of the Tales of Hoffmann was published in Paris, and the ink and watercolour illustrations he created for this book were a significant showcase for his highly distinctive stylistic approach. Although undoubtedly representational, they were far from realistic, and they were possessed of an unearthly, occasionally surreal quality. And many had clear echoes of avant-garde stage and film set design. A year later, he created more watercolours for the first of two books by Baudelaire. This was Les Paradis Artificiels, and in 1935, he also illustrated Les Fleurs du Mal. But frustratingly, there's only minimal evidence of his work for these books. In the later 1930s, he continued to create more overtly erotic material for the magazine Seduction. But apart from this, I can find nothing until 1951, and a couple of compelling tempera-painted fantasy illustrations from Guido Gazzano's story, The Three Talismans. And from this point on, all the evidence seems to be tantalising glimpses of later projects, including several book covers from the early 1950s, some magazine covers, and a pair of dazzlingly beautiful children's illustrations from a book of songs published in 1956. In his later career, it's known he returned to Italy, and there he mainly worked as an artist, but also created set designs for theatrical productions. And Mario Labocetta died in 1988 when he was 89 years old. That's the end of this Italian quartet, and I hope to see you next time around when the next batch of heroes is ready.